Hello again and welcome to this video, which will talk a little bit about the Yi framework version 2 and then go on to look at how we install a Yi website using Composer on Windows 7 and to set up a local website that we can use to work on that site. So firstly, I just wanted to cover some basic topics. Hopefully most of you who are web developers will understand why a web framework is a good idea. And a framework is a good idea because one of the worst things you can do in web development and certainly in other industries is to try and reinvent things that people have already worked on. And if you think particularly about security, but even about performance and about usability, people have already written these things and they've already worked out what works and what doesn't work. And by having thousands of people or sometimes more using these technologies, we kind of know that they're proven and they're going to work well. So using a framework means that we don't repeat the same mistakes, hopefully, that other people have made in their web development. And so then the question, why PHP as a language? Well, there are other languages to choose from, and perhaps some people might think that PHP is a little old-fashioned, but PHP is very well supported. It works very quickly. It has many, many features, both in the core libraries and also in various extensions that are available. And really, as a general purpose programming language, really many, many sites still use PHP. And I'd certainly recommend it as a starting point, even if you want to use something else in the future. So then, why Yi, and specifically why Yi 2? Well, Yi is a reasonably modern framework. And the reason that's good is because it includes lots of functionality that older frameworks perhaps haven't included. So the security libraries are very mature and very easy to use. And it has lots and lots of features like internationalization, like logging, like mail, like active record database classes. And all actually written in a very user-friendly way. And in addition, Yi, like other frameworks, uses the model view controller pattern. So again, it's something that you're probably familiar with from other frameworks, and Yi continues with that. And Yi 2 really is a fairly major update on Yi version 1.1. So it's largely the same ideas, but they've been done in a slightly different way, making use of namespaces particularly, and some other new features found in later versions of PHP. So in terms of installing it on your Windows box, or if you like creating a Yi application, you need to have a working PHP installation, and the version needs to be greater than PHP 5.4, and that's because Yi uses features that are only available from version 5.4. And to check that you got a working PHP installation, of course, you just could just create a local PHP file, do something like echoing PHP info just to check that that's all working. So that's nice and easy. And another thing is you'll need to enable at least 3 PHP extensions. So you'll need to edit your PHP .ini file, and in the extension section, you'll need GD2, which Yi uses for capture. You'll need the MB string, which will be required by some of the modules that Yi uses. And you'll need OpenSSL, which Composer uses in order to download the packages for Yi. So at least those 3 will need to be installed. And potentially, very soon afterwards, you'll perhaps be using the MySQL or the SQLite database extensions, or even some of these other ones, but we don't need to do that for the purposes of this video. Once you've done that, if you're using IIS, you should restart the CGI process for PHP, and you can do that by finding the process, which isn't actually running on mine, which is php_cgi.exe, and just kill that process off. And then when it restarts, it will have reloaded your PHP .ini. And if you're not sure where your PHP .ini is, then PHP info will tell you which PHP .ini has been loaded. So that's the one you need to edit. Okay, so once you've done that, you will also need to create a GitHub account. And this is kind of unfortunate, really, but the way that Composer works is it uses GitHub to find package dependencies. And because of kind of security built into GitHub, there's a certain rate limiting that gets applied by GitHub. So in order to bypass that, you will need a GitHub account, so you'll have a username and a password. So that's kind of fine. Now, Composer is a PHP package manager, and it's again very widely used, not just on Yi, but on many other frameworks. But it does require that you download and install it, and you can do that in a number of different ways that are described in this Composer document. So this is getcomposer.org/download. You can do it just directly from the command line, but if you're running Windows like I am, you can also run this composer-setup.exe. And it's a fairly simple installation. It will ask you for your PHP exe location, which you can find in Explorer. It will also ensure that you have all the relevant extensions loaded in order to run the Composer setup. And then it will adjust your path setting as well, which is very helpful. And then it will tell you to reboot. So that should kind of be okay. I didn't have any problems with the Composer installation. So if we then go to the actual documents for installing the Yi framework itself, you'll find that you can install either via Composer using curl, or you can, once you've got Composer installed, you can just run these two commands. Now the first one, as it says, you only have to run once, and that is to add the asset plugin, Composer asset plugin, as a global requirement, which means it will be installed under top level Composer, and that just allows Composer to run Bower and npm packages as well as Composer packages. So we run that once. I might as well run it again, even though I've already done that. So if I just run that in here, paste, and it will do its stuff. And that's nothing left to do because I've already run that myself. So then the second command you need to run in the web root that you want to install your Yi application into. So I have created a directory here that's got nothing in it called webroot. And if I now copy this second command, oops, come on. Copy that and paste that into here and run this. What this is actually doing, if we look in Explorer, we'll see that it's created a folder called Basic, and that was the name that I gave it here. You can give that any name you like. And then under Basic, what Composer is doing is it's actually creating an application template. In this case, again, I specified that I wanted the Basic application template. Oops, it's gone now. And it will also download all of the dependencies for this template, and they all get put under Vendor in different directories. And you shouldn't have any problems here, but sometimes what happens is Composer will ask you for your GitHub credentials, which is fine. But if you type them in and press return, sometimes Composer will keep asking you for the credentials, which isn't correct. And there is a bug in Composer. I've only seen it once. But if that happens to you, what you have to do is look in the directory that it shows you, that Composer shows you on the screen. So it will say it's created an OAuth token and put it into, in my case, C users Luke app data roaming Composer auth.json. And this file looks exactly like this, although I've changed my OAuth token, but the token will look something like that. And all you need to do is copy that token and then run Composer space config space dash G for global space, and then the URL github-oauth.github.com, and then your another space, and then that token that you just grabbed from auth.json. Once you've done that, you can then rerun Composer update in the basic directory, and it should re-establish everything. But if the worst comes to the worst, just delete this basic directory, do this stuff, get the token from your auth.json, run this command line here, and then run the second of those yee commands again, which is that one, and then it should all work fine. Like I say, you might not have to do that, but if you do, that's what you need to do. So what you're now left with is you're left with a folder, and the folder that you're kind of interested in is a web folder, because that's where index.php lives. However, there is a requirements.php that lives a directory up. So I'm going to actually initially create the web folder to look at the basic folder and not at the web folder. And that's so that I can access requirements as well as web. So this is all just normal IIS stuff. So if you're used to doing this, you can probably stop watching the video now, because it should all mostly be okay. There is one other thing that you will need to do, and that is that you'll need to edit your yee config before the site will run. But let's have a look at that in a second. So if we add a website, because I've already got a default website, I need to give this new one a name. So I'll call it yee2.test. And the reason I need to give it a name is so that IIS knows which of these two websites to go to when I access localhost on port 80. So I just do that by adding a host name to it. The physical path, like I said, I'm going to go to C webroot basic, and that's the folder I'm going to use. I do OK, and I press OK. Now, of course, yee2.test isn't a valid URL, so I will also need to edit my local hosts file. And you can see at the top here the location of that. It's the normal location. And at the bottom here, I'm going to add an entry which says that I need to go to localhost if I visit yee2.test in the browser. So it's just going to provide some local DNS lookup. And if I now go to Internet Explorer, and if I go to localhost, and if I look, for instance, at requirements.php, that hasn't worked, and that's because I shouldn't have typed localhost. I should have typed yee2.test. And this will show you the requirements checker. So this is kind of saying that for the most part, I pass the requirements, but there are some warnings. So for instance, telling me that if I need to use the SQLite database, then I need to enable that extension, which isn't enabled at the minute. Again, if I want to use Memcache, I will need to install Memcache. So there are a few warnings, but there's nothing red, so that basically means it's working okay. If I now go into the web folder and look at index.php, this looks like it's kind of working okay, which is nice. About contact login. Okay, so that all seems fine. What might happen sometimes, depending on whether your Composer installation fails, is that in your config web, you'll notice here, if I just zoom out, that cookie validation key has been filled in by Composer. If your Composer installation gets interrupted and you run update again, this might not be set in this config, and you'll need to set that to something. If you don't, you will get a big error when you visit this page telling you that cookie validation key needs to be set. So that's all fine. If you look at the contact page, there's a capture. If you don't have the GD extension enabled, again, you'll get an error on this page telling you that you need the GD extension. But by and large, this is basically the shell of a yee application all ready to go. So that's all nice and easy, and hopefully once you've got to there, you will watch some of my other videos where I'll explain how to actually do some development on this yee website. So any questions or comments, please put them in the comment section below. Otherwise, I'll see you in my next video.